Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of the Terror Tangents podcast, the horror podcast that's all over the place. Happy Halloween month to everyone. In celebration of the premiere of VHS 99 on Shudder, I thought today we'd talk about found footage movies and why they make so many damn versions of them. I know not everyone likes the found footage genre, and some in the horror community think it's oversaturated and even lazy filmmaking, and it is true that there are a lot of really bad ones out there, but I really like them myself when they are done right. And even some of the questionable ones, like Paranormal Entity, are still really fun to watch. They are actually some of the only movies that have really scared me in a long time, because they can be very unpredictable and don't necessarily stick to any particular formula. I can count on two hands the movies that have actually scared me or really stuck with me after leaving the theater, and about half of them are found footage movies. I mean films like The Blair Witch Project, Paranormal Activity, VHS, The Last Exorcism, and Creep really had my adrenaline going and haunted me long after the credits stopped rolling. I think Creep is actually really underrated too and not on everyone's radar, but it was really good, so definitely check that out if you haven't already seen it. Today, people probably associate Mark Duplass mostly with his acting gigs in shows like The Morning Show, Room 104, and The Mindy Project, but his performance in Creep was brilliant and incredibly scary, because you just had no idea where that movie was going or what was going to happen, and that really keeps you on the edge of your seat the entire time. And that movie does not disappoint, because it gets very weird. You should also definitely check out the Duplass brothers' movie Baghead if you haven't already. It is also really scary, but has some good laughs as well, and it pokes fun at Hollywood in a fun way too. I got the chance to see the movie at a screening where a lot of, quote, Hollywood insiders were in attendance, and the whole theater was cracking up at a few points, and it was such a good time. I also think The Last Exorcism is underrated too, as it was very good and scary. But who does Eli Roth know at the MPAA? I mean, seriously, this movie was produced and, quote, presented by Eli Roth, but it got a PG-13 rating, even though it has a lot of sexual references involving a minor, it touches on things like incest and demonic possession, and it has a teenage girl giving birth to a demon child. But that's just PG-13? Then you've also got Eli Roth's movie Hostel Part 2, which is also a fantastic film, but that was just rated R, even though it shows full-on penis and then shows that penis getting chopped off and fed to a dog, as well as having a scene where a naked chick rolls around in a bathtub while a young girl hanging upside down above her bleeds out all over the place. That's just rated R? Shouldn't that have maybe been an NC-17? I have actually been in awe of Eli Roth for years because of how he manages to skirt the MPAA rating board. It's pretty admirable. Then you've got recent movies like Don't Worry Darling, which had maybe like one or two F-words and two sex scenes, and that was rated R. But you've also got Where the Crawdads Sing, which was only rated PG-13, even though in that movie, you see a teenage girl literally get punched in the face, thrown to the ground, and raped. I mean, I was way more uncomfortable during that scene than I was during the two sex scenes in Don't Worry Darling. I guess the sex scenes in Don't Worry Darling were a bit explicit, and in my opinion, they were actually kind of over the top and a little bit ridiculous, but at least they were consensual and the woman was enjoying herself. I mean, you know? Anyway, I am sometimes amazed by the decisions of the MPAA, and I've also often wondered who writes those little blurbs they put on the movie posters and trailers that explain why the movie got the rating it did. Have you ever, like, really read some of those? Some of them are pretty damn funny. What a fun job that must be. Screen Crush has actually compiled a list of some of the funnier ones over the years, but a few of my favorites are Twister, which was rated PG-13 for intense depiction of very bad weather, War of the Buttons, which was rated PG for mischievous conflict, some mild language, and bare bottoms. That's pretty specific. And then you have Alice in Wonderland, which was rated PG for fantasy action slash violence involving scary images and situations, and for a smoking caterpillar, of course. And then there's Team America, World Police, which was rated R for graphic, crude, and sexual humor, violent images, and strong language, all involving puppets. And finally, you've got 50 Shades of Grey, which was rated R for strong sexual content, including dialogue, some unusual behavior, and graphic nudity, and for language. So what exactly is the unusual behavior? I don't think it's necessarily the BDSM, because that is probably included in the strong sexual content and graphic nudity. So I'd be curious to know what they meant by that. I haven't read the books, but I will admit that I finally broke down and watched the movies during the pandemic, and they are a guilty pleasure of mine now. The dialogue is just so funny and awkward, and it really made me laugh, especially that boardroom scene in the first film. It's so good. Also, what college girl in the late 2000s doesn't have a working computer or access to email? Maybe that's the unusual behavior the MPAA was referring to. Anyway, speaking of Don't Worry Darling, I thought it was actually a pretty good movie. I know it's getting panned pretty hard in certain circles, but I will defend it because it was not what I was expecting at all, and I actually left the theater with a lot to think about and a lot of questions about what was going to happen to the characters after the credits rolled. I also didn't think it was just some generic, quote, woke feminist movie like some people are trying to make it out to be. I don't want to spoil the movie for anyone that hasn't seen it yet and actually wants to see it, but there were all kinds of interesting characters and issues in this movie. There were bad men, yes, as well as men who were caught up in doing bad things, but didn't necessarily have really bad intentions. And there were also women who were partaking and committing bad acts as well. So I think it's a much deeper movie than it is being given credit for. Actually, I thought it was much more about desperation and income insecurity and loss and grieving than it was actually about misogyny and men just being evil or bad. It did start off a little slow and awkward for me, and the acting seemed a little off at first, but when you get to the reveal at the end of the movie, that actually makes sense, and you understand why things seem so off in the beginning. I definitely think it's a movie worth seeing, and it is much better than you would expect from all of the drama surrounding Olivia Wilde, the actors, and the making of the film. But I digress. Back to found footage movies. The only thing that really frustrates me about them generally is that oftentimes there are several different versions of the movie floating around, so what you end up thinking about the movie or how scary you think it is really could depend a whole lot on which version you just happen to see. For example, I saw The Blair Witch Project in the theater when it first came out in 1999, and it really scared me. Now I'm going to spoil the ending here, so if you haven't managed to see that movie in the last 23 years, you may want to cover your ears for the next few seconds. I actually loved the ending where Mike is standing in the corner of the basement facing the wall when Heather approaches, because although it didn't really show you much, you knew from stories told earlier in the movie what was happening to the characters, and what my imagination came up with is much scarier than anything they really could have shown me on the film. You find out earlier in the movie that back in the day, a serial killer named Rustin Parr was possessed by the Blair Witch, and she made him bring children down to his basement in pairs, and he would have one stand in the corner facing the wall while he killed the other child by disemboweling them and carving symbols into their skin. And then he would repeat the same process with the child standing in the corner. So in the movie, when you see Heather go down into the basement of the old house they stumbled upon in the woods, and Mike is standing in the corner facing the wall, and then she starts screaming and drops the camera, you can vividly imagine what is happening to her and their fate, and it's pretty terrifying. In fact, I'm getting chills right now just thinking about it. It was a very satisfying and scary ending, in my opinion. However, on the 10-year anniversary of the film in 2009, I went to a screening of the movie at the Egyptian Theater in Los Angeles, but I was shocked to see a different and shorter version of the film than the one I saw before, and it didn't include the scene where they find out about Rustin Parr. So at the end of the movie, you've got this guy standing in the corner and Heather screaming, but you have no idea why or what's going on, and then the movie just ends. From what I could put together, I believe this version that I saw in 2009 was the original version of the movie that premiered at Sundance and was also released on some promo VHS tapes that were circulated before the theatrical release as part of the found footage marketing campaign. But then they added the explanation scene to the movie for the main theatrical release. And thank God they added it, because I think it made it much scarier to know what was happening. And I think I would have been really disappointed in the film if I had just seen that original version and the movie just ended with the guy standing in the corner with no explanation. I mean, I can see why people who just saw that original version might not think the movie was scary at all. I mean, there are people walking around today who have a very different perception of this movie than I do, based on the version they happen to see, and that kind of bothers me a little bit. Another example is the 2018 movie Unfriended: Dark Web, which was released into theaters with two different endings, and it was random as to which ending you were going to get at any given theater, and they didn't really tell anyone ahead of time. So there are people walking around who have seen different versions of that movie and don't necessarily even know it. I saw what they generally call ending A in the theater, where again, spoiler alert here, every character ends up dead and the final guy is run over in the street by a white van. Ending B, which I didn't see but I've read a lot about, seemed to be much scarier, although some characters do get to survive. In that ending, the final guy gets buried alive and suffocates to death while his girlfriend, who is deaf, sits in the cemetery above him and is watching it on her phone, but she can't understand what he is saying because the hackers have changed the text of his messages and have messed up the video so she can't read his lips. I mean, that ending sounds much scarier to me than the ending I saw, but I never got around to visiting the theater again to try and see if I could catch a showing that had that other ending. They did something similar with the 1985 dark comedy Clue that starred Tim Curry and was based on the Clue board game. That movie was sent to theaters with three different endings as a way for the studio to try and get viewers to pay to see the film several times, but apparently it didn't really work because the movie flopped at the box office. It did subsequently attain cult status on VHS, though, where they had all three endings back to back, and I did like watching that movie on TV when I was young. The biggest example for me, though, at least, is Paranormal Activity. And I'm going to have spoilers here again, too, so if you need to cover your ears, do so now. So a few years before anyone knew anything about this movie, I was extremely lucky to get to see a version of the film that only screened publicly once. Paranormal Activity actually had three different versions that played in a theater. The one that was ultimately widely released in theaters in 2009, where Katie throws Micah's body at the camera at the end. Another version that screened at a few film festivals, where Katie's friend discovers that Micah has been murdered and calls the police, and then the cops force their way into Katie's home and shoot and kill her. And then this third version, the version I saw, which screened one time in Hollywood in like 2007 or early 2008. And that version was much scarier than the theatrical release and was very different in many ways, not just the ending. There were actually a lot of differences between the two versions, but from what I can remember now, the biggest differences were that in the earlier version I saw, there weren't like a lot of sound effects to let you know when something scary was about to happen. You know how in the theatrical version there would be this noise like a whoom before something would happen? Well, that wasn't in the version I saw, and it was just silent. So you didn't know in advance when something was about to happen. And that, as you can imagine, is much scarier. The early version I saw was also longer, and it had many more nighttime scenes in the beginning that were more subtle. There were a lot of scenes where Katie and Micah are sleeping, and you aren't even really sure if you saw something or not, but you would hear these little noises, or you would see like a shadow go across the wall, or the door would move slowly a tiny little bit, or something like that. And if you blinked, you might miss it, but it was really effective at building tension, and it honestly got to the point where I was dreading the nighttime scenes because they were building in such a slow and creepy way that I just knew things were gonna get really scary by the time it was all over, and the anticipation was killing me. They also toned down some of the scarier scenes for the theatrical version. For example, in the theatrical version, there's a scene where Katie is standing on the staircase and her hair moves as though something brushed up beside her. Well, in the version I saw, that scene was much more pronounced and aggressive, and her hair gets smacked around, almost like it was being slapped by the demon, and she reacts accordingly like she's really scared. It was a much more intense and loud scene in the earlier version I saw. They also showed more of the scary videos Micah found online in the earlier version. Finally, the ending was totally different and incredibly intense and scary as well. Instead of Katie throwing Micah into the camera, we still hear the commotion and fight that happens between Katie and Micah off-screen downstairs, but then it goes silent and all you hear is this stomping sound, so it sounds like something incredibly heavy is walking back up the stairs. It's Katie, clearly fully possessed at this point, and she's covered in blood and holding a large butcher knife down at her side. She walks into the room very heavy and stiff-like, and then walks right up to the camera so that the upper half of her body is in the shot. And then she slowly reaches up and slashes her throat with the knife and then falls down dead, and the camera just keeps rolling on a quiet and empty bedroom for what seems like forever, and then the camera shuts off. This was by far the scariest movie-going experience I have ever had, and I had to sleep with the lights on for days afterwards. And I don't get scared easily. I mean, I've seen some crazy shit, like a Serbian film and a bunch of those other movies that everyone says are supposedly too shocking or scary to watch. And those movies don't even come close to what that screening of Paranormal Activity did to me. Now, don't get me wrong. I am eternally grateful that I had the chance opportunity to see that earlier version of the movie. But it does make me a little sad that only like a few hundred people, or however many people that theater could hold, have had that experience. And I don't currently know anyone else who was actually there. So I do wish they had just released that original version instead of going in and editing it and making it more suitable for the masses. I know it would have been much more difficult to create all of the sequels with that particular ending, and it probably would have been too scary or disturbing for some theater goers, but man, was it a damn good and scary experience that I wish more horror fans could have shared with me. I know they did ultimately put the alternative ending, dubbed the suicide ending, on the DVD as an extra feature, but it's just not the same seeing just a little clip like that. And there were a lot of other differences too, so I really wish I could get my hands on a copy of the full version of the movie I saw during that initial screening. Anyway, looking forward to the future, I am excited about VHS 99, even though I haven't really loved any of the VHS installments since the first one. I mean, they've been okay, but not nearly as scary as the first one. I am really happy that Johannes Roberts is contributing a segment to this new one though, and I am excited to see what he does. Can I just say that Johannes Roberts makes miracles with water? I mean, if you have seen the pool scene in The Strangers Pray at Night or the 47 Meters Down movies, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. I went to the theater three times just to see that pool scene in The Strangers Pray at Night, and that scene really moved me. The choreography is beautiful, and the colors of the red blood in the water with the lights poolside were gorgeous. And I didn't know until I saw that movie how badly I needed a horror movie set to Bonnie Tyler's Total Eclipse of the Heart and Air Supply's Making Love Out of Nothing at All. That pool scene, as well as the bridge fire scene, were amazing. I also really liked the 47 Meters Down movies as well. I actually went to the drive-in to see Ready or Not, and 47 Meters Down Uncaged was set to play afterwards. Our group had an early morning, so we weren't planning to stay for the second film, but we ended up standing around outside of the cars chatting for a while after Ready or Not ended. So although I couldn't hear 47 Meters Down Uncaged, I could see it on the big screen in front of me, and I would just glance at it every so often during the conversation. So anyway, I'm standing there and we're all talking about something, I have no idea what, and I just happened to look at the screen at one point toward the end of the movie when all of a sudden, this huge shark jumps up out of the water and grabs this girl in midair. And I swear, I gasped out loud and almost fell backwards. It was amazing. And it totally interrupted the conversation with the group. I was absolutely blown away because it was breathtaking. So yeah, I'm a pretty big fan of Johannes Roberts, and it will be really interesting to see if water makes an appearance in his segment in VHS 99. I kind of hope it does. All right, well, I could go on forever, but we're going to go ahead and wrap up this episode of Terror Tangents here for today. We've got some exciting movies coming out in the next few weeks to look forward to, including Pray for the Devil, which is one I'm really excited about. What did you all think of Halloween Ends, by the way? I haven't managed to see it yet, but I know people are pretty divided on whether it was good or not. Thanks everyone for tuning in, and if you liked today's episode, please hit those like and subscribe buttons below. And until we meet next time, let's all try not to go off the rails.